Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Presbyterian Church here in Winneconne this morning, where our mission is to share God's love and shine God's light. And we hope you feel the love and light of God as you worship with us today, whether in person or at home. I'm Annie Leonard, and we have preaching today, Greg Bratz. Wonderful to have you back. We'll take you whenever we can get you. Are there any announcements in the life of the church today from out there? Lana?
I just want to remind everyone who can't hear, but we're having fellowship again today. We had so many goodies from the Chili Supper that we're sharing. And there's two of them that goes into the same.
Oh, yeah. How did the Chili Supper do?
We made about $392, but that's before expenses. We had about 70
bowls of chili. So it was a success. The chili supper sure was a lot of good chili there. Millie, you have an announcement. Wonderful. Any other announcements? Then I'll ask for prayer requests, joys, concerns. Rosemary will be coming back in the next couple of days from her trip out to Virginia to select the appointments for the inside of her condo.
Prayers for...
Oh, okay. Prayers for Rick and Alex Davis, father and son, and for David Moratz, a glass artist from Coventry Glassworks. So prayers for those three people. Going once? Okay. Let's stand as you're able for the call to worship. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks on the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him, for I rejoice in the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Praise the Lord.
Let us pray. God of unchangeable power, when you fashioned the world, the morning stars sang together, and the host of heaven shouted for joy. Open our eyes to the wonders of creation, and teach us to use all things for good, to the honor of your glorious name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let's sing We Gather Together, number 336.
Still our defender wilt be. Let us free.
The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Please join me in this unison prayer. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Hear the good news. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Try.
Please pray with me. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes to us today from the Old Testament book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 through 7, and 34 through 41. The Lord speaks. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand who marked off its dimensions. Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone while the morning stars sang together? And all the angels shouted for joy. Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you, 'Here we are'? Who gives the ibis wisdom or gives the rooster understanding? Who has the wisdom to count the clouds? Who can tip over the water jars of heaven? When the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together, do you hunt the prey for the lioness and satisfy the hunger of the lions? When they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in a thicket? Who provides food for the raven when its young cry out to God and wander about for lack of food?" And the New Testament reading is from Hosea 11, verses 1 through 9, God's love for Israel. "When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. But the more they were called, the more they went away from me. They sacrificed to the Baals, and they burned incense to images. It was I who taught Ephraim to walk, taking them by the arms, but they did not realize it was I who helped them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with ties of love. To them I was like the one who lifts a little child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them. Will they not return to Egypt, and will not Assyria rule over them because they refuse to repent? A sword will flash in their cities. It will devour their false prophets and put an end to their plans. My people are determined to turn from me. Even though they call me God Most High, I will by no means exalt them. How can I give you up, Ephraim? And how can I hand you over, Israel? How can I treat you like Admah? How can I make you like Zeboim? My heart is changed within me. All my compassion is aroused. I will not carry out my fierce anger, nor will I devastate Ephraim again, for I am God and not a man, the Holy One among you. I will not come against their cities." Thus ends the reading.
Well, good morning. Good morning. Here's a couple of things before I get started. Well, choir, it was wonderful to hear you again. I have to say I miss all you guys, so that was enjoyable. On a personal note, if you notice, Ellen is with me this morning. So I appreciate, we appreciate the cards, the letters, and particularly the prayers that we receive from you guys as she's been working on her recovery, doing well in that regard. And in fact, we have planned on Thanksgiving Day, we're leaving for a cruise to Spain and then across the Atlantic ending in Miami. So we're still going to do that trip. And then of my entourage who is here, there is one member who has often came that is missing today. Ellen's mother, my mother-in-law, Barb, she had to go to memory care this weekend. So also someone to keep in thoughts and prayers. So with all of that, please pray with me and pray for me. Lord, thank you for the ability to gather here this morning. We've heard your word read. It's now time to hear that word proclaimed in such a way that we can find a way to create and build your kingdom here on earth. Amen. Now, the first reading that we had this morning comes from the book of Job. And in many ways, it's one of my favorites because it's beautiful prose that reminds us that God is God and, quite frankly, we are not. It's a verbal demonstration of how God, in many ways, is beyond our human understanding. What we are given this morning is a very small portion of a 4-chapter divine speech. And in the rest of the speech are some of my favorite images. Question that God asks Job that remind Job and us that we have a God of creation. So you can take chapter 29, verses 1 through 3. Do you know when the mountain goats give birth? Are you there when they crouch and deliver their young? Then there's verse 5. Were you there when the wild ass went free? Verses 19 through 20. Do you give the horse its might? Do you clothe its neck with its mane? And 26 through 27, one of my favorites. Is it by your wisdom that the hawk soars and spreads its wings as it goes south? Is it your command that the eagles mount up and nest on high? As I said, the divine images go on for 4 chapters. But why is Job asking God all of these questions? For as Annie read this morning, at the beginning, there's some rather harsh ones. Were you there when the foundations of the earth were set? To understand why all the questions, we have to go back to the very beginning of the book of Job. So in chapters 1 through 2, Yahweh makes a bet with what we'll call the heavenly district attorney. All has to do with Job's faithful loyalty. Now, many translations use the term Satan, but quite actually, a better translation would be the accuser. This character that is talking and debating with God is not some guy dressed in red with horns and a pointy tail. The accuser proposes that the only reason that Job has been faithful and loyal to Yahweh is because Yahweh has blessed him and protected him. If God were to strip away all of those protections and blessings, Job would curse you to your face. The accuser, however, is proved wrong. First, Job's blessings and then Job's health are taken from him. But in the end, Job did not sin anymore. Because Job is not aware of this bet, Job wants an audience with Yahweh. He's convinced of his own sinlessness, confident that he doesn't deserve what he got. So when God appears in the whirlwind in Job 38, what we might expect is some type of legal proceeding and debate between God and Job. That God and Job will litigate the management of God of the universe in Job's situation in particular. But if that's what you're looking forward, you will be disappointed. Because nowhere in these chapters does God take up Job's case. Instead, God talks about the very order of creation itself and challenges Job on what little he actually understands. God strongly reminds Job that he has no standing to criticize God's management of the universe. And God does not address Job's situation or Job's questions about justice. God does not even acknowledge that Job is suffering. The images and the creatures that are described in the divine speeches grip our imagination, introduce us to a world much, much bigger than ourselves. God is God, and we are not. And while it is agreed that the prose found in this portion of Job is absolutely beautiful, theologians do debate the possible tone that God may have used when questioning Job. Many believe that that tone was harsh. How dare you, a mere human, question God? You know, there's questions like, gird up your loins, and I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Sounds a lot like a parent shouting at their child, sit down and listen and don't say a word. Sounds like someone said that out there before. This would currently go a long way in the idea to believe how many believe the God of the Old Testament is about. An angry God who constantly is mad at the actions of the creatures that were made in his image. But quite honestly, I'm not convinced that this is the case. I have to wonder if God's tone wasn't more along the line of a parent sitting down their child and pointing out the parent actually does have a great deal more experience than that child. And because of this, the parent may have a better understanding of the situation than that child does. The parent might possess wisdom that that child does not yet have obtained. And I really believe that is true for two reasons. The first is where the book of Job is placed within the other books within the Bible. This book is not placed with the prophets. It's not like Jeremiah, which is dominated by doom and gloom and condemnation. No, Job is placed in what's referred to as the wisdom section of the Bible. Job is next to the Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and the Song of Solomon, books that are meant to instruct, to provide wisdom, not to condemn. And the second reason I believe the tone God uses with Job is that of a loving parent, is because of the passages like what we find in Hosea today. But before I go into details about Hosea, I want to tell you a little story. Now, as all of us go through life, we collect what are sometimes indelible images of important events in our lives, images and feelings that we will never forget. And for one of those memories is the birth of my son, Alex. Now, the memory isn't of that actual birth. I must admit the details of that are a little bit fuzzy. But there were a few minutes after he was born, the doctors needed to spend a little bit of extra time with Ellen. So while the doctors were with Ellen, Alex was wrapped up in this blanket and handed to me, and we walked the hospital floors for a few minutes. I will always remember walking, holding him in my arms, with his beautiful blue eyes staring back at me, his eyes filled with curiosity, wonderment, possibility. The walk was but a few moments, but there are moments I will never forget. Now, Alex grew up quickly. He learned to walk, to ride a bike. We had wonderful imaginary games. We built Lego cities. He had his medieval period where he was fascinated with anything to do with knights and castles. And that was followed by his Egyptian period, where he was always fascinated by the fact that before they mummify somebody, they pull their brains out through their nose. You know, the types of facts that young boys are fascinated with. But then came those teenage years. There is not enough money in the world to get me to live through those years again. He changed from an outgoing blonde boy to a black-haired, sullen teenager. There was rebellion. There was acting out. There were times that there was heartbreak for him and his parents. Boundaries were pushed, punishments dealt out, and there were more than a few sleepless nights. But luckily, that's not where the story ended. Everyone got a little space as he moved on to college, and the underlying love prevailed. Old wounds forgotten, and new, more mature relationships developed. And today we love being in each other's company and doing things together. So why am I telling you that story this morning? Well, that's because of the reading from Hosea is a passage written by a parent for parents. In many ways, that wonderfully written prose closely parallels the story of Ellen and I with our son. It might provide some insight into God's discussion with Job. Now, as parents, we love our children intensely, and there are times, however, we would more than cheerfully throttle them. There are times when they drive us to distraction, There are times when they drive us to tears, both of sadness and joy. Today's passage in Hosea tells such a story. It tells of God's love for Israel, God's distress in Israel's disobedience, but the ending with the assurance that God will always love God's creation. The passage is truly amazing in a number of different ways. And those differences are what lead me to believe that Job is being addressed by a loving parent, not a harsh one. This passage gives us some unique insights into God. First, it's written in the first person, as if God were talking directly to us. And the second, and I think even more fascinating, it is not written as God the Father, it's written as God the Mother. For verse 4, I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down and fed them. Conjures up an image of a mother breastfeeding her child. We also learn that God can have a troubled mind, conflicted between her need to punish her disobedient children and her overwhelming sense of love. The chapter surfaces a number of questions about God. Does God have feelings? Does the divine have emotions? Does God sometimes feel like gathering up and hugging us tenderly, and other times feel like strangling us? Does God sometimes roar with laughter, and other times roar with pain and suffering? Hosea starts out the story compassionately. It speaks of God bringing her children out of Egypt to care for them. When Israel was a child, I loved him. The divine parent speaks of children, of teaching their children to walk, of picking them up when they fail, and of providing healing. Expressions and emotions all parents can identify with. The passage then moves on to another emotion that most parents can identify with. The emotions of a child spurning a parent's love and affection, resulting in intense frustration. Hosea writes, they kept sacrificing to Baals and offering incense to idols. And while our teens may not always worship pagan gods, they can turn away from their parents through direct disobedience, drugs, alcohol, sex, or many other number of destructive behaviors. God then expresses an emotion that many other parents again have felt, confusion. What action should you take to punish your disobedient child? God has reached out with love and compassion, and yet Israel has chosen to go astray, spurning God's compassion. You can sense God's confusion in verse 8. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? God contemplates letting them fall into the hands of the Egyptians and the Assyrians. That will teach them. Since the people of God are bent on turning away from God, she contemplates the possibility that she isn't going to lift them up in their time of trial. You made your bed, now lie in it. Do I cast the child off, or do I hold that child close? According to Hosea, however, God's frustration is short-lived. Luckily for Israel, God is God. She does something that many parents have a hard time doing. She states while she is unwilling to give up on Israel, her passion grows warm and tender. Now, don't get the idea that God has gone all soft and can be manipulated by a child. While God looks tenderly on her creation, she still allows Israel to be invaded. She still allows the temple to be destroyed. She allows her children to be scattered. The people of Israel have grievously sinned against God, and there will be consequences for their actions. But the consequences aren't the end of the story. In verse 10, it states, the Lord roars like a lion calling her children home. And the lion here isn't a lion that roars to strike fear into those who have disobeyed. Instead, the roar is more like the lion Aslan from the Chronicles of Narnia, a roar that is meant to call the scattered children home. It is a promise that after a period of separation, There will be reconciliation. Now, before I go and push the image of God as a parent too far, as far as Job reminds us, God is God and therefore not like an earthly parent. And while all of us like to think that we understand our earthly parents, the truth is there are aspects of them we can never fully know or understand. And this is even truer for our heavenly parent. For as it says in the Confession of 1967, God is a mystery beyond the minds of men. And this is the point that God is making for Job. While I believe God in many ways is a mystery, I also believe we can gather insights into that mystery by thinking of God as a divine parent. This image can help those of us who have been children be better parents to our children, or be better children to our parents. I perfectly find it comforting to know that when I have felt that combination of love, anger, confusion, and satisfaction with dealing with my children, God has exhibited those same feelings in dealing with hers. With this as a caution, what does the 11th chapter of Hosea have to say to us today? Well, first and foremost, this chapter of Hosea is a remarkable testament to God's love and desire to save her people. Hosea speaks of a people, a nation, led by a loving God, a person who will lose their way over and over again, a people who are filled with ingratitude for all that divine parent has done for them. But still, as lost as they are, God finds them and brings them home. God finds them up and lifts their burdens. The chapter reminds us that none of us are too lost for God to find. None of us are too lost for God to stop looking. So if in your life you ever felt alone, lost, forgotten, separated, remember that image of a God as a divine parent. Take comfort in the knowledge that your divine parent has not forgotten you. Your divine parent will always love you. No matter how far you stray, your divine parent will always call you home. Reconciliation with God is not only possible, it is also what she desires. In the end, God reconciles with Job. The Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Second, sometimes we all too often think of God as that cosmic judge or scorekeeper. We kind of have this image of an old man all dressed in white flowing robes sitting on some heavenly throne. Near him is this immense book where he records all the good and bad that we've done in our lives. And then somehow on Judgment Day, there's this balancing of the good and the bad that determines whether we're going to be able to walk through those pearly gates. However, that image is nothing like the images we find in Job or in Hosea this morning. There's no amount of good the people of Israel could have done to compensate for their sins that they had committed. But that's not the way parental love works. The parental image of God is not based on the work accomplished or the good deeds done, nor the number of times we have sinned, nor the number of times we've had to ask for forgiveness. Mothers and fathers love their newborn children even if they have accomplished nothing. Good parents love their children regardless of their merit or their accomplishments. Loving relationships are never about keeping score. And finally, as we read the headlines in the news reports, particularly these days, we do see real human suffering and wonder why. In these times, I hope we can remember the words of our God, our mother in Hosea, "I am God and no mortal. I am the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath." God does not approach her sinful children with wrath. God does not will human suffering. God does not cause suffering. God in her heart, God in her very core, rebels against causing suffering to God's children. A parent's hearts break when they see their child hurt or suffering. But of course, there is suffering. God does not intervene in the laws of nature to prevent it. God allows the results of our actions to play out. But God does not wish for our suffering. God does not seek it to cause it. God wishes to live, to thrive, to be healthy, so that we can be just and kind and good. Showing mercy instead of vengeance, providing bread instead of bombs. And when we do suffer, we can be assured that it's God who, like a divine parent, will be there to lift us up, to heal us, to comfort us, a God that never leaves our side. So what can we learn from Job's one-sided conversation with God and Hosea's parental struggles? Well, I believe we can take great comfort when we put Job and Hosea passages together. From Job, we get a small understanding of the immensity of our God. And to paraphrase in the last chapter of Job, when Job was asked, what did he learn? Job says, I learned things that were too wonderful for me, wonderful things that I did not know. And we too, if we are in communication with our God, can learn things that are just wonderful to know. We learn that we have a God mighty beyond our comprehension. But the beauty of having a God that is beyond our comprehension is what we also learn from Hosea, and that we learn that same immense God is also our loving parent, a parent who is there to lift us up, a parent who is there to comfort us, a parent that never leaves our side. And all this we can be sure. Amen. Join again now in song.
Thank you, Greg. Please stand, and our congregational response is hymn 39, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Faithfulness, morning, morning.
can be seated. Scripture declares the Lord, the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. Let us then return to God the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth.
John, that was a beautiful work with hope. If you could all please stand and join me for our offertory doxology, hymn number 188, Jesus Loves Me. Please join me in the unison offertory prayer. Blessed are you, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share.
Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Amen.
You can be seated. The prayer this morning is a prayer, a petition. After each petition, I will end with, Lord, source of all love, if you could answer, hear our prayer. So please now join me in prayer. Mother God, in those whose love and live and move, we pray for a world that is crying out to feel loved, a world that needs to be wanted, that wants to be cherished, who seeks to be unique. Lord, be with those who are feeling lonely, discarded, or unloved. Lord, source of all love, hear our prayer. We pray for a world torn apart by conflict and war, a world that lives uneasily in a climate of fear, with no clear vision for future days. Lord, we ask that you be with the people of Israel, Gaza, Lebanon, Ukraine, and all the other places in today's world where there's war. In particular, we ask that you care for the innocents that are being hurt by these actions, the women, the children, the peacekeepers. Lord, source of all love, hear our prayer. Creator God, we remember that you gave us your creation so that we could and should care for it, not to destroy, manipulate, or use for our own personal gain. We send our prayers to the victims of climate change, as we think recently for the hurricane survivors in Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina. Lord, source of all love, hear our prayer. Mother God, we pray for a world that thinks less of others than itself. We are a world where division between nationality, race, religion, politics leads neighbors and families to distrust and distance themselves from each other. Lord, as we get close to this next election, we ask for leaders that think first of the good of all people and not narrow personal interests. Lord, source of all love, hear our prayer. Mother God, we pray for a world that is short on happiness, too busy to enjoy this world that you have created, too preoccupied with living to appreciate life. We know that there are people, Lord, who are grieving, people without hope, people in need of healing. Be with them, care for them, hold them in the palm in your hand. And this morning in particular, we lift up Rick and Alex and David and Barb. Lord, you are the source of all love. Hear our prayer. We pray for the world that needs your love, God. It needs your hope. It needs your peace. It's greatly in need of your joy and anxious for salvation. A world that needs to know that it's special, unique, and is uniquely loved by a heavenly Father, a heavenly Mother, a divine parent. Lord, we pray for all these things. Lord, source of all love. Now, Lord, let us join together in one voice, praying the prayer that you taught your people to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us join together in the closing hymn.
Stand if you're able.
As we leave this morning, do so with the assurance, the knowledge, and the confidence that you have a God who wants to lift you up, heal you, comfort, and never leave your side. But it does not stop there, because those are the things that God gives us and God expects for us to give to our fellow human beings. God wants us to be there to lift up others, to heal others, to comfort others, and to be by their side. Our worship service is over.
Our service in the world begins.
Let it be so. Amen.